Hello friends, namaste. I'm myself Dr. Vinod Kumar. I'm a professor in the Department of Samhita, Sanskrit and Siddhanta. And this is a lecture series on Ayurvedic psychotherapy on a contemporary understanding. Psychotherapy is a very familiar term to any practitioners irrespective of the system of practice. And also in the case of Ayurvedic practitioners also, this term is very familiar. But when we prefix a term Ayurvedic to psychotherapy, there may arise a confusion on how this Ayurvedic perspective differs from general practice of psychotherapy. We have any number of references or any number of theories related to concept of mind, concept of psychology, the psychotherapeutic approach, and so on in our classics. But the precise practical guidelines regarding such a therapy is not that much clear as far as our literature is concerned. But while reading in between lines, we can bring out a better clarity in the concept of psychotherapy, even though by definition psychotherapy is mentioned in Charaka Samhita many places in Charaka Samhita, that psychotherapy is even translated as Sattvavajaya Chikitsa, which means the restraint of mental activities, or Ahidepyo Arthepyo Mano Nigraham, restraint of mind from abnormal activities. Okay, on one side that definition is there. On the other side, while speaking about the treatment protocols, summary of treatment protocols for Sharira and Manasa Dosha in Charaka Samhita Sutrasthana first chapter, the Manasa Doshas are being addressed or being alleviated through a precise approach of Manasam Jnana Vijnana Dhairya Smriti Samadhi Bhi. So such precise guidelines are there regarding approach to psychotherapy, but what we lack is the practical model or practical module to approach how to implement jnanam, vijnanam, dhairyam, smriti and samadhi in our day-to-day practice. So there should be an effort to translate the conceptual understanding of psychotherapy to a practical understanding. Here is a humble effort in that background. And before proceeding to the actual core content of psychotherapy, in this part of class, I try to review on the concept of mind, concept of manas in our classics, to make a logical background to explain what psychotherapy means in our practice. So with that introduction, I may proceed to the class on concept of mind. Mind is considered as one among the most complex phenomena in the universe as we understand it, because even after the advent of modern psychology or modern psychoanalysis by the master of psychoanalysis Sigmund Freud in later 19th century, he also explained mind to be mostly unconscious than conscious. So the visible phenomenon of manas or mind is a small piece, small fragment when compared to the invisible or unobservable or unconscious motives of mind. So the inner mind gets more attraction while the modern psychology comes to the scene. So there are something inner or something dormant inside the mind which are not explicitly visible to the external behavior. So that much complexity is there for the phenomena of manas or mind or psyche. They call it as psyche. But as far as Ayurvedic descriptions are concerned, Our acharyas start with a precise and simple description regarding mind. For example, you take the description of mind in Charaka Samhita. The mind is enlisted under nine dravyas, Navadravya. It started from Vaisheshika Sutra, and Ayurveda accepted that consideration and considered Manas and Atma as two among Navadravya. The reason is, if you allocate an entity under Navadravya, under Dravya, you can easily go for explaining their attributes and activities, or guna and karma. If you want to explain some activities, if you want to explain some attributes to an object, initially you have to allocate such an object under the list of dravya. Then only you can move on to explain what is the guna and what is karma to that object. In that sense, Manas and Atma are included under nine dravya. Otherwise, you are not able to explain the guna and karma. So some activities, some attributes and all. So the minimum essential qualification of an object to have guna and karma is to allocate the object to the category of dravya. Then only you can proceed on to explain the dravya in terms of guna, karma, samanya, vishesha and samavaya or abhava or whatever it may be. So that is the basic minimum need of including Manas and Atma under the category of dravya. On the other side, our acharyas precisely wanted to locate Manas somewhere in the body. It can be Hridayam, it can be Mastishkam, or it can be precisely as per our Bhelacharya, it can be Shirastalvandaragatam. Whatever it may be, there was an effort to locate Manas precisely somewhere in the body. So our acharyas wanted to impart that much precision in defining the location of mind. That is one thing. Another thing is, our acharyas tried to enumerate Manas also. What is the number of Manas in a body? How many Manas are in a body? There will be a single mind. That means our acharyas wanted to enumerate or number the quantity or quality of Manas. So that is another way to how to approach an object precisely. Precision is brought about through enumerating an object. Another area is describing the attributes. As already mentioned, ekatvam is an attribute of mind. Like that, anuttam also is an attribute. Anuttam means it is minute. So defining the size. So defining the location, defining the number, defining the size, and precisely defining the attributes. Like there are three attributes like sattvam, rajas and tamas. All these data, all these descriptions point out that our acharyas wanted to describe the phenomenon of Manas in a precise, simple and concrete approach. This is not to simplify the complexity. Definitely there is a complexity in the case of Manas. For example, if you describe an object with three attributes of contradictory features, something like sattvam, rajas and tamas, these are the three distinct attributes of Manas. Not only Manas, anything in the universe, but here in the case of Manas, there are three attributes like sattva, rajas and tamas, which are mutually contradictory by themselves. So describing such attributes to mind, it contribute to the building up of complexity, because three attributes together, if we consider three attributes together, constitute a phenomenon. That phenomenon itself will be complex, because like the three colors, three basic colors are there. With that three basic colors, with different combinations, permutations and combinations, you can make any number of colors. Like that, with these minimum three attributes to human mind, you can make any number of constitution or mental constitution that may differ from person to person, that may differ from event to event, that may differ from experience to another experience. So that complexity is involved in the case of manas. But apart from directly entering to such a complexity, our masters tried to limit the descriptions to some concrete concrete and precise definable nature of the mind as to impart a simple entry. It's not to make the complexity simple, but to make a simple entry to the complexity, especially for the beginner learner of Ayurveda. So for a beginner learner, to present a complexity as such will make some problems. To avoid such a problems, our acharyas tried to make a simple entry by defining the location, by defining the number, by defining the precise characteristics, or by defining the precise attribute, something like that. They tried to make a simple entry to a complex. Complexity is otherwise established, because while advancing to the description of personalities, like Satvika, Rajasa, Tamasa personality, there can be any number of combinations, any type of personality apart from the 16 personalities described. And even while going to the Rajasthamas as Mano Dosham, and the treatment aspect and psychotherapeutic aspects and all, we will be advancing to the complexities of mind. But the entry point, they deemed the entry point, our acharyas deemed the entry point should be somewhat precise or somewhat simple as much as possible. So that is the way in which our acharyas approached the concept of mind, not to simplify the complexities of mental phenomena, but to make a simple entry to the complexities. This is the primary thing we have to learn while dissecting or while analyzing the concept of mind. The first thing will be, does mind exist, or is mind existing? So by the definition given by Dravya, given for Dravya, that is Dravya is one which has quality and activity. Manas has its own qualities, manas has its own activities. So we have to take it granted that mind is existing. Another way of proving the existence of mind is related to the cognitive process. So if you consider an object. So cognitive process means the process of making knowledge about an object. So object will be there. Distinctively, there are 5 sense organs for each object. Can be Shabda, Sparsha, Rupa, Rasa, Gandham, and the sense organs, corresponding sense organs are there. Imagine there is not an entity. There is no entity called manas. It is not there. Imagine a situation like that. So Atma is there. Atma is always there. So we are trying to establish manas is different from Atma. So if at all these 3 agents are there, sometimes knowledge does not occur. For example, you take the famous example of Shakuntala. The object was the sage Durvasa was approaching Shakuntala. The object was Durvasa, and her eyes were opened, but she didn't know the presence of Durvasa. Why? There was something not in that place, or there was something absent. That factor you can call as a beta factor. This beta factor, when it is present, the knowledge process, cognitive process will be completed, and there will be knowledge. So there is a factor which you can call mind or manas or beta or alpha, anything. Such a factor, if it is present in between Indriyam and Atma, there is a knowledge process is completed, and when it is absent, there is no knowledge. So this factor is responsible for making the presence of knowledge and making the creating absence of knowledge also. In that way, manas is termed to be lakshanam manaso jnanasya bhavo abhavayevacha. Jnanasya abhavo bhavayevacha. So mind is there because knowledge is interrupted. There is break in between production of knowledge. Knowledge is not always a continuous process. If soul was the soul representative or soul responsible factor for knowledge, or if you consider there is not an entity called manas, there is no manas, then naturally whenever Atma is present, knowledge also should be present. That means Atma is present from birth to death, continuously Atma is present all over the body. So knowledge should be continuous. But in reality, it is broken. You can have a knowledge at this moment and the next moment you can have another knowledge. Simultaneously, the previous knowledge is absent. So there is a breaking system, or the knowledge is not that much continuous. Knowledge itself is broken into pieces. So there should be a factor which causes this brokenness. Such a factor is called manas. So beta is a factor, call it manas, mind or anything, which when connects sense organ to the soul, the stimulus gets received properly. So that means manas does exist separately apart from the indriyam, the shariram and the atma. So that is the proof for existence of mind. That is why we explain lakshanam manaso jnanasi abhavo bhava evacha. We will move on to a modern concept of the psychology is a study of psych. And psyche is the totality of human mind, conscious and unconscious. In modern psychology, the mind is, or psyche is explained to be conscious on the top and unconscious at the bottom. The major part of manas is told to be unconscious, as I have already explained. There is a term psyche, which can be equated to mind, or it can be consciousness, anything. There is no division of psyche. It's a single entity explaining all the phenomena of the manas. But Ayurveda, or in turn Ayurveda and the darsanas in India, or Indian psychology, has a slight different opinion regarding the constitution of psyche. There are three distinct portions of what is called a psyche in modern psychology. One is Atma. We define Atma as Jnana Adhikaranam. Adhikaranam means the final abode or reservoir or consciousness. And the Manas is a Sukhadi Upalabdhi Sadhanam. Sadhanam means a mechanism or instrument. So there is an instrumental part, or there is a mechanism for being conscious. Consciousness is the quality of attribute of any living organism, but to exhibit this consciousness or to express this consciousness, there should be an instrument. That is why if this instrument is becoming dormant, you feel unconscious, or you feel unconsciousness, or you define coma. In a coma state, Atma is there, consciousness is there, but it is not expressed. Or life is there, Jiva is there, but it is not expressed. So there should be, apart from Atma, there should be another agent which express the mechanism for being conscious. You can call it as a manas. And the indriyas are again the instruments assisting mind in bringing out consciousness, because for receiving some stimuli from external environment and for expressing the behavior. Behavior are expressed in two ways. One is a psychological behavior and the other one is psychomotor behavior. Psychomotor behavior means some karmendriya should be there. The behavior is executed through, or you can call the behavior is the response. So response can be executed through some karmendriya. So you need some, manas needs some assistance of some other instruments to execute the responses and even to receive the stimulus also. Manas itself or manas alone cannot go to the external world and receive the inputs. There are five sensory organs, sensory faculties to receive the input and hand it over to Manas. So in that way, Indriyas are the instruments assisting mind and in bringing out consciousness. So simply the comparison goes like this. In Western psychology, there is only one entity called psyche, but we divide the whole psyche into at least into two. That is Atma and Manas. Atma is the abode of consciousness, but mind is the, Manas is the mechanism of being conscious. And in another comparison, the psyche is the abode of thoughts, affects and behavior. These three terms are called a cognitive triad in Western psychology. Cognitive triad. There are three types of affairs, three discourses happening through the psychological mechanism. One is thought, one is the affect. Affect means to feel, feelings, and behavior. Behavior is the response. So you can have some thoughts. If an event occurs, you can have some thoughts about that event. You can have some feelings on that event, and you can behave accordingly. So these three components are essentially present in any psychological activity. So these three things are called a psychological triad. But in the case, when you compare this one to Indian scenario of psychology, there are, as you we agreed, there are two components, that Manas and Atma. Atma is the final custodian of all types of impressions, feelings and behavior. So it is the final authority. So that means for a living organism, Atma is present. So when Atma is present, there will be some impressions. You can call it as bhavana or smriti or something like that. There will be some feelings and there will be some behavior. Volition means behavior. But Atma alone cannot bring out or execute all these things. As we already explained, Atma needs the assistance of Manas. So when Atma is the custodian for all these types of attributes, Manas is the customer. Manas is the customer means Manas approaches Atma for taking out impressions, for taking out the feelings, and for taking out the behavior, basic behavior, and execute. So this is, as we have already explained, it is the instrument for executing things. So mind should be the customer of impressions. So the user of impressions, you can say. Customer means user, or one who customizes these impressions, and one who adopts the feelings from Atma to feel itself, and the executing the thoughts. So Atma is the custodian of all these things, but the custodian is unable to execute anything. But Manas is the, you can say, the customer who brings out all these things into a practical situation, to a practical implementation, or executing all these things in a practical way, which is suitable to a particular situation. All these things are there anytime. With the Atma, everything is there anytime. But Manas is a factor which streamline or which select these types of attributes from Atma and behave according to the needs of the situation. So that much relationship is there in between Atma and Manas. Atma is the custodian, and Manas can be called as a customer.